Okay, guys, I'm back. I'm starting the afternoon session, now starting the YouTube live, and let me share my screen first. So, okay, one thing, guys. Have concerns. I'm still converting the morning video from morning session, but hopefully there is no technical issue in Zoom streaming. And the YouTube video starting muted. Okay, so okay. Thank you for coming back, and let me resume the part I left off in the morning. So we are working on the interaction method in the agent algorithm, and I show the example of, and I didn't show like this example. I show the example of the code which I sent on over email half an hour ago, so you should get that right now. But anyway, but now I leave this code, and I actually show a bunch of examples from tutorial website, and then so let me do that. And I want to keep the chat window open in case. So yeah, that's the branch our agent with collision detection we did in the morning. So I mean, that's one thing. And then actually, sometimes when you go a certain type of complexity with this branching type of complexity, without collision detection, that becomes too much chaos. Just simply everything jammed up. So you would need collision detection to give certain order, or at least not intersect. And then, so I'm gonna show you a bunch of examples, and not, but technically, or in terms of like how to, or what kind of code you write, they are kind of same, mostly same. And they just, agent behavior is different in those example code. So, but including, I mean, outcome or result of how it's gonna look at the end is important, not for coding, but for computational design. So yeah, let me go through those with description about, not there about technical part, but like some design part. But first technical part, or let me run this code first to show what this does. In the meantime, let me check other stuff. YouTube running, video still converting, and processing is coming somewhere. Where are they? And that. And then also I should not accidentally, but anyway, so this is the agent, branching agent with. So this one is not that circular as before. It's more like 60 degree turn. So it has that hexagonal aesthetics. And it, yeah, actually that's mostly just because the code is, actually same code in the tutorial, but code has a rotation with a 1/3 of pi, which is a 60 degree. So plus 60 degree turn, minus 60 degree turn, and then nothing. Actually, this dir.dup supposed to be duplicate, it's exactly the same with copy. it's a bit redundant to have both methods. But anyway, so that so this branching is actually three-way branching. So it has a three different direction to go. So one agent creates three, but each of them is limited by the random probabilistic switch. And then actually this irandom.percent is exactly the same with irand.pct. Actually, this is just shorter version, that was longer version. So then so probabilistically changing, and then so each of them is inside if function. It's not inside else if and else if. It's not exclusive, so everything could happen at once, or it's possible nothing happens. Then collision detection. Collision detection part is same with what I explained. Also in the diagram, there's a diagram to show, so it's kind of same thing that I showed before. So it's checking the endpoint of line agent. In this case, it has point two. Previously, I had a position and direction, so position copy with direction was endpoint. Then there's a clearance, so that's a distance you check if it's colliding or not, and then that cannot be bigger than the agent length itself because it's gonna collide it to parent. And then yeah, so that's a part. And then so this is showing the this is diagram of the update part. So it's branching into three, so it has a three different child agent, and then one is 40 degree, no shit. One is 40%, 60 degree, and another is 80% straight, and then yet another 40% and minus 60 degree, 60 degree. So then actually this part of a percentage control is a bit sensitive, meaning if I make everything 40%, I mean, it sounds fine to just maybe not to have too many lines, but there is some crucial point, a crucial number or threshold where it means, let me just show you what that means, which means actually none of agent comes out. So if none of them comes out, it just ends. So if it's too small, that happens. But usually these are like a, I mean, it's not, there's no theoretical turning point to stop, it's just a tendency. And there's no specific one number to decide that. But usually when this kind of threshold happens, threshold around that, so something barely happens tends to generate something interesting usually, because it's not too chaotic, not too simple. And but it's just a tendency in agent-based algorithm. So it's kind of related to the notion by Stuart Kaufman of the edge of chaos. Actually, this is not really edge of chaos, but the edge of chaos tends to show the order. So that's kind of, just conceptually, that kind of a threshold area is something interesting happened that ended. But anyway, that was a side track. But anyway, so this was an example with that actually this logic of intersection or interaction to check intersection was same with before, but with this specific update method with the three children with 60 degree turn was creating that kind of geometry. And then, so another example shows different type of result in terms of a kind of geometric sensibility. Let me copy and run. So this one is just coming from the website, so I don't save, but I mean, you can save if you have record. You want record of what you did in the workshop. But so this one is coming. So you see that like a geometry, it is different because, you can see that's because of different angle. And the code is kind of same with the previous one with the 60 degree. It also has the like a 60 degree and the 118 degree, but it's inside the random number. By the way, so again, the I random is the same with I rand class. Then, so this one is randomly turning between 60 degree to 120 degree. So that's so that randomness plus that range gives you this look, almost kind of look like certain ancient urban aggregation. And then, so I mean, to our eyes, this angle matter. So this is not a part of the compute, the coding technical issue. This is more related to architecture, aesthetics, and then kind of understanding of your or understanding of like geometry as a culture. So so this range meant something to us in terms of culture in architecture, and then the 60 degree meant something else. It's a bit like certain type of sci-fi sensibility there, like Tron type or something, or even the certain era of Zaha Hadid type, kind of thing. And then meaning, so if you control this into something else, it totally changes, not really totally, but aesthetically it changes. So you, as a computational designer, you should have certain keen eyes to have a sense of sensibility or like responding to the number, like what angle means what. And especially from like a, some just referencing certain talk I did yesterday, especially the trend of like rational geometry, et cetera, or module or discrete, there's a certain thing to respond or respect human architectural cultural heritage that somehow tends to be related to rational angle, which is 90 degrees. So if I make it 90 degree term, that look could be different in the way you can imagine. So let me see what happened with 90 degrees. So I dated randomness, so it's a specifically deterministically 90 degree in the positive direction, negative direction. And you can imagine that that I mean 90 degree. A maze-like thing is coming from that agent, or I mean branching algorithm, plus it's random branching, so you get this random. Sometimes random spot, well, most of them random, but I like some empty area, etc. But and you might, coming to me that resembles or that reminds me that edge of the cup of ramen bowl. But anyway, so that this is another thing. And then, but if you want to go, but this also shows certain type of aesthetics. So this doesn't really remind me. Los Angeles city grid, that's more organized. And then that unorganized quality came from the randomness I'm using. So plus the branching logic on the top-down grid doesn't, I mean, you could generate the top-down grid out of agent, but this doesn't have that. So, but anyway, so that just about the angle. Out of curiosity, actually, another thing, not really another thing, but another sensibility a bit related, so like, certain rational geometry camp or discrete movement also has tendency to use 45 degree. So just showing. Okay, this is a case I just accidentally, this number was accidentally not enough. Well, this might be related to the collision detection. My clearance is too big, so. Half. Actually, this could accept certain intersection, but it doesn't collide itself. So, some everything. By the way, that 45 degree might need to accept like a 1.41 something that route to. So yeah, it has certain sensibility. It kind of looks like. Rational, but something might be something else. Or is this also getting closer to Tron direction of the with the 60 degree? And I'm kind of curious why a dual rating use a 45 degree turned L shape many times, but maybe next time. So that is kind of a design sensibility related to number. So that's kind of an important thing for computational designer to know or understand or have sensibility. Anyway, going back to interact method. And so The other one's got so another one. Actually, if you are exploring like this algorithm, you might be curious that so that was 2D, and then you might be curious what happens if it's 3D. And then this is a 3D example. And as you saw on the website, it doesn't look organized. So, but mostly, I mean, that's related to the sensitivity of numbers, that randomness might be the main cause. So it's getting a bit chaotic. Yeah, so that's because of two reasons. One is because of a random number, and this wide range of random number creates this messy sensitivity. So it doesn't look any regulated sense. But another thing is that when you go 3D, it's easier for agent not to collide in 3D space. In 2D, especially line intersection, our intersect method used the distance check, meaning it's checking, on 2D was a circular range to check if something colliding, but in 3D it's a spherical check. So that part is kind of okay, but still in 3D, it's easier for agent to go anywhere. It's less probable to collide into something. So that's one thing. Then maybe I'll be going back to the numerical sensitivity. Maybe if you want to have a more kind of regulated sense or control sense or sense of control in terms of aesthetics, you might have some regular number like a 90 degree or 45 degree. I'm just curious what happens if it goes 90 degree. Just curious by myself. But one problem is that this one has not only random percent, random angle, which I just deleted, it's not random angle anymore, but also had a random axis, random rotation axis. But this is a bit, this would be a problem. Because it doesn't really rationally rotate. So let me see. Regular turning angle, but random axis direction, that might end up random. Something you want to say soon. So even though the angle is always 90 degrees, it doesn't give us too much rational quality in geometry because of random axis. So axis is kind of important. So you can keep it. This code I should save or maybe preview somebody. Anyway, let me first save this code. I'm gonna send you saved code later over email. If random, I'm totally on the sidetrack of tutorial sequence on the page, but I'll be talking about like a process of like computation design, like what if you feel like this was wrong and going to other direction. In this case, I'm feeling like I want this to be more rational, which I didn't feel in that way 10 years ago, but now I feel. So, maybe I can put regular axis. I just type in a regular way. So this is 90 degree, this is X axis, kind of. But you also see problem. If I rotate everything in X axis, that would mean it's coming. First, that's not the issue, that's the other issue. One, Rotation 90 degree, 90 degree, 100 axis, it's such a random problem. 100%, 100%. Yeah, sometimes this happens like accidentally collide everything each other and then not going anywhere. Or randomly, possibly like if I have 50% of this, 50% of this, 80% of this, meaning if in the probability of 50% and 50% and 20% nothing happens, that could happen as well. I don't know if that was what happened. This doesn't seem that's the reason why it happened. So, and then going back to something else. Something wrong. This is called debugging to find what was wrong. And then usually what I do is if that's probability problem, I always keep one of the 100. In that case, not that's guaranteed to have one at least. And then 90 degree rotation of all of them, would we collide each other easily? Not sure. If collision is problem, I want to decrease this clearance to zero something again. And something came, which is chaos because I change back to random angle. And then what if it's not random angle? Axis X 100, this length is one, although the length of axis should not matter at all. You can start it where? Okay, that should be something else. Okay, let me, but anyway, first of all, this was not exactly what I wanted to do. Thing I wanted to do was, first of all, what is the first direction? Oh, first one is going X direction. So rotating something in X direction would be always ended up not rotating. So I need to do Y. That was Y. This was colliding each other. I rotated 19 degree along the axis of the line itself, which ended up creating same line on the same location. So, but anyway, what I want to say is, I wanted rationality, but I wanted also 3D, so this doesn't give me 3D. So the issue is that I cannot just have one axis. So what if I have random three axes? So one of them is plus very fast and has to be the Y or Z, but if I have randomness to say it might be X axis or Z axis or I need LCF. Last one for X axis. But so in this case, actually, it might be Y axis to rotate, or it might be Z axis to rotate, and it might be X axis to rotate. So that might switch like a turning 90 degree in space in a rational way. So although that adjustment of percent is something you can think about. It's not guaranteed or equal. And it's also not the guarantee to have the first one being X axis, which collide and not then stop. So let's have it happen to go in this way. I'm gonna show one trick or tips when you are using randomness and it happened to go wrong in the first place because of randomness. In this case, randomness happened to choose the x-axis to go first, so it's equal. And then concept of randomness is something a bit different from pseudo randomness using computer. The randomness you use in computer is not exact randomness. The pure theoretical randomness usually happens in the quantum radiation zone area. But so the simulated randomness is something else which comes from mathematics, and especially the randomness I'm using on Azure library is a repeatable randomness, meaning every single time you run random thing, but they're gonna do exact same random sequence, which is different. Actually, so that it's a bit different in processing other computer, but I intentionally did that in case you find something you like with randomness, and then if you run again totally randomly, you never get the same thing, but I want to have the same thing, so I keep the sequence of random either same every single time. But sometimes you don't want to change. To change randomness, in IGO library, using the irandom or irand method, you can change that by in random number or pseudo simulated randomness, there's an idea called seed number. Actually, I don't use this. There's a certain key number for any sequence of random number to start with. It doesn't start with that number. It's just whatever number identify a specific sequence of random number. And you can change that by init method in IGO library. And I think default is zero, which is gonna do the same thing. But if you change any different number, it doesn't mean zero to one gonna create similar sequence. Every single different one gonna create totally different sequence. So, but anyway, so if I choose this seed number three, that might not happen to give agent x-axis rotation to collide. But it might, I don't know. Let me change, I see that, it did. Okay, if so, I'm gonna change that to smaller probability. And then, actually, in reality, if you, okay, so I'm having the weird issue, which I should not care right now, that some axis of rotation 10, we will terminate agent if their rotation angle matches with the angle. Let me show. If you want to control precisely, what you have to do is actually for advanced programmer coder, you would choose axis based on the current direction. If you exclude the case if this axis is parallel to your agent direction, which you can do with like, yeah, it's parallel axis. You can do that. But anyway, that's advanced, I think. So, but anyway, right now it kind of worked, and then it tends to go sideways more than vertical, which that might be related to this number, which I don't know. But what I wanted to show was just aesthetic curve difference, this versus this. And that was caused by the level of national level limitation by number, keeping everything 90 degree turn, and they using only X or Y or Z axis to turn. So that's, but just that I'm just showing the comparison with number and aesthetics. So, and if you are curious, actually, I'm just curious, what if that's 45 degree? 45 degree in 3D, not 45 degree turn in 3D tends to be messier than you would think. Actually, I would think, so not sure if I'm right or not until I see the result. So, game. Maybe. Yeah, so it getting a bit, you lost that kind of sense of a flat plane somewhere. You kind of, what, well, you a little bit see that. But yeah, so 45 degree in plane would be fine, but 45 degree in 3D tends to go a bit too off. But one more thing I'm curious to do is that, what if 45 degree happens in very limited occasion, 1%, 45, other 90%. I mean, this is just my curiosity. So like, you might want to go, I'm just kind of exploring the kind of adjustment or parameter to fine tune the result. And in this case, I was curious to see that very irrational thing to happen, but slightly mixed, not really randomness, but irrational thing. And then although it was not a little bit, it was totally dominant. So another thing is that if you introduce irrationality to rationality in bottom up, a small rationality could tend to destroy all rationality. However, this one seems to be a coordinate system just off, so not. But anyway, because if you have a flat plane system or a kind of level system, it looks like a flat plane, and that's why it looks organized to us. Once you treat everything like a slight degree, and then after that, that parallel slope stayed there and totally destroyed something. But anyway, it's just that I'm talking on the tendency of a system. So that was just an example of just my way of my process of design exploration. And then just trying to see going back and forth between the result and then checking the design result in terms of sensibility and then going back to number and what caused it and then just keep checking. So this is just I try to have slight regularity into regular system. So that's a kind of design process example demonstration. And then, by the way, even but 90 degree whole thing still not necessarily new aesthetic thing. Kind of remind me like an old Windows screen saver. But anyway, that was the example. Let me save this as another file. So by the way, for the afternoon, I'm gonna kind of keep doing this kind of demonstration design process, and I just show you a bunch of example of an interaction method, and that's not totally different. Okay, let me show you this example. Another thing, the reason why I went off the talk about design sensibility is because this workshop is a little bit focus on that area, as I talked about rational geometry and then kind of turn of sensibility in architectural culture from biomimicry aesthetics to rational or some other direction. Though I'm opposed to take that turn, I just try to keep both under one logic. So let me run this. So this one is this one is not exactly collision detection because you see some of the sphere is pushed out. So actually I don't exactly remember what this code does, but okay. Does it delete? I don't think this delete. This only changes location of itself, stop there. So it's kind of pushing each other. So it's different from collision detection. I mean, it checks a collide, but when it collides, it pushed itself to avoid the collision. So that's how it's doing. But this is a little bit different also from like physical simulation. Like a physical simulation collision is like a ball colliding and push each other. The bouncing is another thing, which I don't exactly have the, I mean, similar one or particular level exists in the tutorial, but I don't have the solid level. But anyway, so this one is a kind of quick, simple, not bouncing, but like a sphere pushing each other to not to overlap each other. And then that's done by this like less than 10 line code. And they actually own during the course, I thought of mentioning something. In the morning, I was going to mention about like a list of methods for participants or viewer who's more curious about checking more stuff. So I mentioned actually, for example, if there's a some method called DIFF, I use here, which I didn't explain so far. This is another vector operation you can use, a vector method out of IVEC class. And then, so it's like adding or subtract or multiplying. This is another thing. This is just taking difference between one position to another position. Well, okay, one vector to another, it's just subtracting and create a new vector. So, but there's like maybe less than 100 operations existing in the library. And then I just talk, quickly show you how to know what's existing. And then one thing you can do is in the tutorial website, there is something called documents. So documents is kind of a comprehensive list of class and the method. This is a, so this is an API document or whatever, like a manual of library. So problem is this is too detailed. So it's a bit difficult for beginner to find what information where. So then actually this is just automatically generated from a library code itself. We call it JavaDoc, but at least if you want to know vector operation, first thing you need to know is what class you want to look into. And in this case, the vector class is called IVEC. And then you would search IVEC here. You can just type search IVEC there as well. There. And then another thing you might notice, there's many variations of IVEC, but at the moment you should not care. Here is the major thing you look into. And then, so inside that, let me close this. So this is IVEC class, and then this has a list of methods you can use. And then actually, I thought this should look different. So that contains, this page contains a list of methods you could use there. And then I thought there is a summary. Okay, method summary. So method summary. So method is the thing you can use with this parenthesis. So like a distance is one method, and the if. If is another method, then this is a list. And so it shows that there's an add method, and then there's angle method, so you can measure the angle between two vectors. But you can also see there's a several different version in add, several different version in angle. The difference is the input variable, different type or different number of input. So you could add XYZ, or you could also add vector, simply add, but you could also add the vector and some number. W is a floating point number, like 0.1 or 1.7, something. But this one is like a scaled add, like you multiply this number to this vector, then add, so that kind of variation exists. But anyway, so those are lists. So if you wonder there's anything, if you kind of think of something you want to do and wonder if there's some operation existing in the library, that's how you check. And then, but you only kind of guess from name. Most of the time, I have some small description, but most of the time, it doesn't mean much. So that's my issue. I should write more, but anyway, so that's those are list. And then, so that's all, also like 100 or something, that by each of them that, so it's like tons of methods you can use. But anyway, so those are something you can check in case you are curious. Then let me go back to the interaction method. So I showed the Sophia pushing agent, and another one is, let me just copy and paste this one as well. This one is a rectangular agent, and then yeah, the agent is called rect agent. In terms of naming, it's a conventional thing, it's nothing technical, but usually the name of agent or name of variable, everything should mean something to you and also to somebody else. And there's another thing I have to show. my processing just crashed, and because of the reason, I don't know, I kind of guess why, but that error might be worth explaining. It's technical issue, but so okay, it kind of worked and then stopped working. And I'm kind of guess why it happened. First, let me show the fix, I guess. And then let me explain what that means. So this might or might not fix that error. So the thing, what I did was issue of synchronization, meaning so this library runs agent and create geometry and draw the geometry on your screen. And those things actually happens asynchronously in case one of them is too heavy and then I didn't want them to stop. So, but this part is super technical and for beginners that you don't need to know at all. But the agent, so in default setting, it's asynchronous. All of them, the like building geometry and the agent, building geometry and agents, can running agent and then display in the geometry in the, on the screen is asynchronous. So each of them having different time frame. But sometimes that creates problem, especially when you are deleting some geometry. In this case, some of the rectangle is deleted somewhere in agent. Where is that? Rectangle is deleted here. So, but if you delete something in the middle of display, or processing is drawing something on display, that crashes processing. That's why it crashes. And then to prevent that, you use this line. You can just copy and paste when you find something on the tutorial. Actually, yeah, some of the code has this. So there's a option to force processing, or IGO to run synchronously with the drawing on the display and the agent and geometry creation. So this kind of slows the execution. But when you are deleting something in agent, you kind of have to do it. And then tomorrow, example in the hierarchical agent, they all have this because actually, no, I'm not deleting, but anyway, in case it has this. But anyway, that was just technical issue about the reason why it was crashing. But this agent was using interact method, not for collision detection, but kind of similar to the spherical one. This is changing the size of rectangle. So every time it sees other agent colliding, it changes the size. And then after it changes, if it collides another, it also changes again. So that's why it's like this. So although, yeah, in this example, I was kind of just passing certain type of geometric pattern. But anyway, so that was actually, I wanted the rectangular pattern, which doesn't intersect. So, but random. Then, so that's the example of that. And then this has a bit longer lines of interact method because it's checking like, what if it's colliding on the left side of the rectangle or right side of the rectangle and top and bottom of each of them is that kind of check happening there. So that's one example. And another example is here. Let me copy and paste. And then I totally shoot the option the code. This one is a cellular automaton, if you know what that is. And then this is a topic I easily go sidetrack, but so okay, first of all, cellular automaton is some kind of mathematical logic to simulate certain pattern. And then this logic was found in complex system science. Although it might be earlier than 70s because it was, it's not to be found by von Neumann, scientist, the person who should, actually first of all, I'm a huge fan of him, the person who should have won Nobel Prize, but he didn't, and the rumor is that he wasn't human. But anyway, so he, I mean, he's the guy who invented the computer in the first place, allegedly. And then, so this one is simulating that logic of cellular automaton. If you Google cellular automaton, which I'm gonna do right now. So that, yeah, I see, you see that pattern. So that's logic. That's kind of one-dimensional version. Actually, one-dimensional version kind of taking up each level. And then there's a 2D version or 3D version or any version exists. But so basically the logic is each cell, which is represented by square or box or something in this case. So that one, so each square or box, actually I'm making box in the code, so it's 3D, but each of them is first of all agent. So the cellular automaton is communicating with neighbor. Also, in the beginning, it doesn't have a neighbor, and then this agent also create neighbor if they don't have next to it. So that's the part here. So in a way, this is kind of branching as well. So this first agent, first cellular automaton, will create that three child. Actually, it's not creating. Each other. One agent actually moved down. So this one gone just, this agent didn't delete itself. It moved down one step. You can see there's a position add by size. So then this was, so then created both neighbor. And then, so this agent created the left neighbor, and then this one created. So even when you see no box there, agent exists. Agent just decided not to draw box there. So, but that represents a state of a cellular automaton. I'm just, yeah, right now I'm just explaining the cellular automaton logic. So cellular automaton has an internal state of 0, 1 in the simplest form. And then that one is represented here in as a having box or not. And then you can see in the update method, it's state equal one. So there's a state. The state goes 0 to 1. You can write with a Boolean, but I use number. So if it's 1, you create box. But that state is keep changing with the negotiation with neighbor. And how to talk to neighbor is done by this part. So like rule is something like the if the left neighbor is state is 0, and then right neighbor is 0, and if myself is 0, I keep myself 0. And if it's left is 0 and the right is 1, and then myself is 0, I change it to 1. But anyway, so those are rules which you can design. And but there's an example for Neumann design, so which shows certain pattern resulting. Well, similar, resembles some pattern, nature pattern, especially the shell pattern. But one thing you can play with, so this is a kind of major rule of cellular automaton. So this with two neighbors, there's only 8 different cases of condition, like left and right and myself 0, 1. So there's a total 8 different case. And so what number to put here totally changes the result. So I'm just randomly changing the number to something else. This is in case you want to play with cellular automaton, that you can quickly play with that. But the interact method is not really used to negotiate with it. Somehow negotiation part is done by here. In this code, just technically, it's just checking, or it's checking where to find the neighbor. So neighbor finding is the part, but automaton finding, well, automaton rule is not there. And then when I mess up my rule quite a bit, it totally changed in a boring way. I don't know what happened. I don't know why it's so regular. Oh, I don't know why, but I kind of see the regularity in my rule. It's 01010101. I didn't know the cluster, so maybe what if I put 101 at the end? But anyway, that's something about Zero Automata in case you want to simulate. But you can just use the interact method to check the neighbor or reconnecting the neighbor. So that's something. I feel curious about Zero Automata. You're looking into John phone. My mind is one thing. This didn't change much. Also, you in the advanced state, you can also check the new kind of science by the person who invented MATLAB. That's his junior scientist as well. So that's one thing. And this, somehow the book was popular at some point in architecture school. And then, so Zero Automaton is this, and then I'm a bit frustrated. I cannot make interesting pattern out of this. And so let me, yeah, I don't leave simply. Hopefully this creates something interesting, and then let me move. I want to move to next. So, but anyway, in this way, I wanna keep showing a bunch of examples of interact method for today in the afternoon. And then, but again, this is something, but again, the assignment today gonna be about designing something using interact method. So I'm showing a bunch of examples, and you can choose some of the examples to pursue more. Each of them is a bit totally different type of geometric result. And then you can stay with the that three-way branching line, or you can stay with explore the Zero Automata or something else, but anything interests you would be fine if we use the interact method. So that's the assignment. So I'm gonna, in the same way we did yesterday and today, I'm gonna ask you to the assignment work, treating it as you are designing kind of small project and just to try to design something interesting by yourself. So that's assignment. Then keep going. So this is a bit weird, but okay, accept that to move on. So, but anyway, so yeah, Zero Automaton, interesting topic. You should look into more. I'm gonna save that code. Then next code. By the way, just another side track. Zero Automata is a little bit related to the cell growth algorithm, my cell growth algorithm, and that's something very interesting. In a way, in terms of topology, using Zero Automata in not on the grid. But anyway, another example of interact method is this one. And five. So this is kind of going back to line-based branching agent. But one major difference is the following, which is coming soon. So this one, and this is a little bit more random branching with collision detection. But one thing you see a bit different from before is that the branching angle is shallow, really small angle to turn. And I had problem having this type of geometry or branching because they are too close and they are seen as colliding and then stop easily. But this doesn't. The reason is that this one has a little bit more advanced interact, actually more advanced collision detection algorithm. So this one actually checks the line intersection instead of distance of endpoint. So, I mean, technique is advanced, but the method is just this. This is another thing you could use, another method inside the vector class, and then using this intersect segment. So this is the line segment method you can use. And each segment is not line. Line tends to mean infinite length line, and the segment tends to mean the short, limited, not really short, but limited segment of line having endpoint and the beginning. So this takes 4 points as the first line starting point and endpoint, and then another line starting point and another endpoint. So A is another agent. So this agent starting point and endpoint, and another agent starting and endpoint. So it is calculating, try to calculate intersection point of two line segment. But if it's far, it does not create intersection point. And that is a case you get this null value. So this is the first time I mentioned about null value. So this is a special value in Java or some other language. Means empty. So that is a one way for this method to tell the case there is no intersection point found. That this is just, this method is designed to do that because I decided to do that way. So if it finds an intersection, it creates a regular vector point, and but if it doesn't, it returns a null value. Null value can be assigned to any type of data type. So right now it's checking if this intersection point result is null or not. If null, that means it's not intersecting. If it's not intersecting, that's not colliding, so they don't need to stop the agent. But if it's not null, I don't care where it's located, but not now means it intersects somewhere, it's colliding somewhere. And so it's now I'm deciding it's colliding. However, child agent is always touching to the parent agent in this agent system. So I'm excluding that case if the starting point is the intersection point, I don't recognize that as collision. Although in rare cases, there might be case that starting point is intersecting with non-parent agent. In that case, this algorithm doesn't work. So that's something you can overcome in technical way, but this one is just simpler. So important thing is this. If you want to have more precise intersection-based collision detection, you can use this. One problem is it doesn't work in 3D because if slightly off, line and line, if slightly off, they don't return intersection. So if it's 2D, this works good. Weak point of this algorithm is this is much heavier than the previous distance measuring collision detection. So if you have tons of the stuff, this might be heavy. But actually, it's not that too heavy, so it's kind of okay to use. So anyway, this is intersection based. 3D intersection based thing, we have another thing, I have another method to use. Then it's included in the hierarchical geometry algorithm I'm going to show tomorrow. So you can see there, just mentioning what it does is it's measuring the distance between segment to segment, not intersection, but segment, distance between segment to segment. So if it's intersecting, the distance is zero, but if it's like 1 millimeter apart, it's one, so you can still check collision of line in 3D. So anyway, that was the example. Then I'm reaching the end of this tutorial page. So, but the whole thing is, actually I have one more. No, this is same. Although I have more interact method example in other page, in another page in the tutorial, I could go there as well. But if you actually, if you have any question, you can type on the chat, which I'm trying to open. Or I keep going. So, but anyway, for the rest of today, just showing a bunch of examples of which you could use for as a base of your assignment work. So that's a thing. Also, maybe actually, because tomorrow we already start going into main topic of the workshop, hierarchical geometry, and meaning I kind of leave other topic in what no other feature of the library, like I don't touch a facade part at all. I don't really talk about how to make surface, although I think I'm gonna talk in the hierarchy geometry, but maybe I can I wanna show you a little bit more interactive method stuff, but also the other feature of the library, like which might be useful. And to do that, I might want to talk about five import export. And also about how to make surface. And then I think that can be explained in the same example of intersect, which is one of them. Let me see. So maybe first I want to talk about surface. I mean, after talking about interact. So I mean, you can see the resemblance of this to the previous agent based branching and the intersection. So maybe I can explain this. Actually I can talk some of them. So first, I'm gonna copy and paste the first code in this page of variation of geometry on multi-agent algorithm. So it's about the geometry and multi-agent. And then let me open new file. So let me run this, but result is gonna be like this. So this one is creating some geometry, not just line, but actually kind of box. And then more precisely, it's something called square pipe. So there's a several or 10 or so methods to use to create geometry in IGEO library. And then just making surface will be explained soon later, but this one is using something square pipe. And I wanna also quickly talk about, I mentioned about the shortcut key F to focus to the extent you have in your screen and the double click to change to the to different window. One more thing you can do is you can change the shading mode. There are four different shading modes. This is transparent with wireframe is default. You can make it solid, not non-transparent solid shading with wireframe by typing shortcut key S for S. It's shading, but anyway, S can change that. Also, if you type W, that goes to wireframe mode. And then there's two more options. If you type Shift and S, that just remove the wireframe from solid shading. And if you go T, T is the default transparent shading with wireframe. But if you don't want wire, you can keep type Shift T. Anyway, that's a shortcut tips. Then But anyway, going back to the geometry, and then it's easier to see in shading. So this stick, a square stick, or something I call square stick, is the some geometry you can generate using this method called ig.squarePipe. And then set random color, set a random color method in random class. You can check that too. But anyway, so that's so this method takes two input and actually one more for the size of the pipe or thickness of the pipe. So the point one, point two is like an endpoint or line, start point and end point, and then the two means the radius or thickness of the pipe. And so that's how you can use. Of course, you change that number like 0.2 to 2, that are going to be much thicker pipe. But anyway, but I want to show the variation of this method. There's other pipe method or other geometry building method in IG class. So I'm going to show you in a second. Also, I think I'm going to open new page and the IGO. I'm going to open the document page again to show the stuff you can do. And then this processing is just showing the much wider or thicker bottom pipe. Yeah, it's almost cube. I mean, they are avoiding collision, but they are, the thickness is just, well, they are collision, detecting collision on line, but they don't do that for side of the cube or pipe. So it looks like this. But anyway, so just to show other variation or other method you could use, because this is a IG class, which is kind of base, or most of the time this is just some sub-evaluated, but this also contains some geometry method you can use, and the IG class is somewhere you can find in the document. And I went too far. So this has, it's not really the geometric class or and the sub-variety is all mixed together, which isn't great, but some of them. Geometry, so you can build arc, although you can also use iArc class. There is that's something else. Axon is about the view. You saw the background color change is also there. Well, yeah, some like a simulation control, like a background color or simulation speed to duration, everything is here. But also the geometry class circle is there. Also, you can also use the iCircle. And I think I even have the curve. But the pipe, or you can use cylinder, you can make cylinder, ellipse, extrude. Okay, extrude is mostly in here. You can use extruded, you can create extruded surface out of curve, or just point as a control point of curve. But you can also set the layer, which can be exported to Rhino. Loft method is there. Mesh is some, I mean, you can use iMesh for creating mesh most of the time, but mesh sphere, mesh stick, you can use a mesh stick. This is Nerve's surface, Nerve's surface square pipe, which is empty in the side cap part. Mesh is something else. You can offset curve, not precisely, but control point base offset, which Grasshopper also has. You can make pipe. So pipe is a round pipe. I can just show you that. Pipe is just a round pipe. Make the radius smaller. Square pipe is, I mean, square pipe. And then, not sure if I had a rectangular pipe, but I do have. So there is a rectangular pipe. You can set different size for width and height. And Sophia, you can make Sophia, although there's I Sophia class as well. A square pipe reference is here. You can make surface, although this is not a typical way to use. I'm gonna talk about how to make surface with I surface soon. And there's more surface. You can make the sweeping surface. Well, sweep, you can sweep curve to make surface. This part I have the tutorial page as well, which I'm gonna show now. And I also have the ground pipe here. So maybe that's it. So yeah, that's what was. So this one, I changed that round square pipe to round pipe, and this seam is heavy. And then square pipe tends to be lighter, and then round pipe tends to be heavier because the number of control points is more, but maybe like a double or triple or something. So that's a round pipe. And I think, yeah, the end is not really closed, it's open. The polygon mesh stick or mesh stick or mesh pipe, I think it's closed for 3D printing. But yeah, so that's one thing, and you can check this this manual or reference. And I also wanna show you some more organized tutorial page, which shows that variation of geometry modeling, should be here. So, okay, so this part I mostly skip in this workshop, but you can check if you want to know more about how to build geometry. And then Navis curve and surface, you can see here. Although I think I wanna explain surface soon a little bit, but the stuff I was talking about, extrusion or lofting, it's described here as well. So there's offset curve method and lofting method. Just extrusion and curve extrusion and then sweeping. So you can check those to see how the variation of geometry modeling in IGEO library. Although me personally, most of the time I just create surface directory out of control points, so I don't use that much, and I use more this. So with that, I'm gonna move on to some other interaction example. So this tutorial page, variation of geometry multi-agent algorithm, is actually showing the sequence of starting from this algorithm and then just adjusting the type of geometry and to get to the point it gonna look like where. But anyway, it's going towards this a bit coral looking geometry. And it just requires certain management of geometry to match the tangent, and then matching tangent is something about alignment of control points. But actually I don't explain fully that part, but some of them. So I want to talk about surface, creating surface on agent, and well, doesn't need to be agent, but on agent. But maybe before that, slightly talking about the issue about tangent and how to match tangent on agent. So this one is a line agent, but the line is not, actually it's not the line segment, straight line segment, it's curve. So okay, first I want to talk about how to draw curve. So let me copy and paste this example. By the way, I'm kind of teaching, this is kind of my teaching style of kind of thinking everything on the fly, and then I kind of forget the original schedule. So let me check what was the original schedule I set up. I think today was all interact method. So I think I can talk about this Then tomorrow is going to be all hierarchical geometry. Hierarchical geometry agent. So anyway, so this is second day or interaction. Tomorrow hierarchical agent. So okay. So yeah, I have time to go a bit sideways to talk about geometry. And so this agent create different. Well, this is not the copy and paste one. This agent create a curve instead of line as geometry of agent. And then, so geometry, agent, wait, that's a, so this looks similar. Did I copy and paste wrong code or did I do something else? Let me see. And then I see something on the chat window, although I don't know the meaning. Sorry. Then I don't think this is the code I want to run. Let me check back. First, close this code. I will stop this code. I gonna run another processing and then this is the one I want to use. I select copy and paste and run. And then I need to check the video conversion. Still running. I don't know if I end this session and then start doing another component. But anyway, so this one is using there's two part in the agent. It's line agent, and the first one here, and I mean first child agent is here, and the other child agent here is here, and that is. Okay, so that's running here. And then this might be too much. I want to stop. So you see those curvature. I mean, it's chaotic, but at least smooth. And so this is created here. So basically, so agent behavior is one thing, but what kind of geometry you put on agent is another issue. So far we are just putting line, and then in the beginning I was putting points, and then this is curve. And then, I mean, you can put arbitrary curve or whatever curve or sphere or surface or box. Previously it was putting the stick. You can do that, but you can also articulate curve based on the parent agent position and child agent position. Let me explain by sketching on Rhino. It's Rhino. So what this agent is doing is it's still relevant to use this branch. But let me delete this collision. So there's a parent line agent. And then there's a child branching agent. So this was the this was an old way of putting geometry on agent. But the agent position was here. So it was like, one agent body is represented by starting point and line towards direction. That was the agent body. And then so child agent body is from here to that direction. But you don't, that's one design of agent body, simple version. But you could do something else. You might be able to, it's kind of tricky to think whose body belongs to who, but for example, in this case, it's created, this curve is created in the parent's agent update method. So this agent is creating curve from, it's using midpoint. It's midpoint of a parent agent and the endpoint of parent agent and the midpoint of child agent. That's what it's doing in the code. So in the other diagram or sketch, it's a curvature from here to here. That's one curve between here. And then another curve is the other way. But anyway, so that's the thing. So the weird thing is that the parent agent is having two body based on the child. You could do that inside the child agent in the case, the curvature belongs to child agent, extending from parent. So by anyway, so that's what's happening in this code. If it doesn't branch, it just go one way. So then in the code, so the technical thing you as a coding learner wants to know is how to create curve in the code. You saw how to make line by just putting two points. But in this case, what you need to do is you need to put three points, for this curve, into the curve. And you also need to specify the degree of curve. When you put just two points, it automatically keeps the other line, and the degree of curve degree of line is one. But when you have 3 points, and then if that's degree two, and so you also have to make number two. Then, by the way, because this code is a bit organized in a specific way, so let me write in a simple way. And removing, I want to copy and paste and make it look simpler. So first, I remove the color, second. In one line, it look like this. It's kind of, same with this. And then you have 3 points. And then, but one more thing is that this part is a bit tricky part. I'm using IVEC and then this square bracket. This might be new to you. And then the thing is I'm giving array of points into curve. And then when you give just 2 points to curve, you can just directly put two of them inside the curve parentheses. But if you need more than two, three or more, you have to put in an array, which it could contain 2 or 3 or 10 or 100 or 1,000. So, but I'm doing inside one line, which is quicker, but messier as code. If you want a more organized way, you can do this. So this is the part I'm talking about array, which I wasn't intending to do, but you can make data type of array of vector by declaring IVEC and square bracket, and then give some name, point array or something. Then you create empty, not really empty, but like a unassigned point array, meaning you need to make a container, I mean, arrays container of data, and you need to prepare a container before you put something in it. So then you kind of need to know how many of them you need beforehand. Then in this case, I know I want to give 3 points. So that's three. So this creates just container of vector you can put. So then I use one of them. So now I put something inside it. The way you wanna do it, you use this square bracket to specify one of array. So square bracket zero and close bracket means the first item in the container of array. And then you can put some vector, although what I want to do is I want to put is a point one, midpoint, point two. So this is, I mean, mid is another vector method in Azure library to generate a midpoint between 2 points without changing the contents of this vector. This creates a new point. This doesn't move. Some of method moves the original points, which might be problem for the original agent. So that's the first point in array, and another one is a point array square bracket one. Second one is one, and the third one is something I want to put here. I just want to put point two, which is the endpoint of the current agent. I want to put point array two, and another one is this one, point two meet something. Let me just copy and paste. So this is a midpoint between the endpoint of point two to the child agent endpoint, which is current parent endpoint, copied and moved to next direction one, which is the child agent direction. So although I could have kept that somewhere, but anyway, so that's it. And if you prepare, so I'm just trying to use the simpler version to understand. So no, so this one line from here to here is creating this array on the fly just instantly there in one line. But more organized way is to create that beforehand and then just put here like this. So point array, three of them, empty container, and putting each of them three times, then you put array, and you specify degree, then this create curve. That's a more kind of easier to understand way. So that's what's happening in this line here. So anyway, so that's how you create curve. And one thing you need to know is that degree two is, and degree one is straight line. So if I change this to degree one, this becomes just a L shape of a straight polyline. If we make it two, that's curvature. And actually degree is actually any integer, although usually you use degree two or three conventionally. And the degree three is smoother than degree two, but that requires minimum 4 control points. So I only have 3 here. I don't have 4. If you have 4, you can use. If you have just 3 points, if you use degree three, you're gonna crash. So, but anyway, that's the kind of basic of creating curve. Then in this case, specifically creating the curve according to the child and parent relationship. And then that creates this tangent aligned continuous curvature. So that was an example of agent and creating geometry on it. Then let me show maybe next surface of that. So next example. And this is kind of surface. Let me copy and paste this one. Then run the code. So 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 this one is creating tiny, but I'm gonna enlarge the window, which sometimes, if I'm unlucky, crash the processing. But so this one is creating kind of still tangent, but triangular surface. And then let me stop. I want to see something close. This doesn't have wireframes, so I'm turning on wireframe option, but yeah. So the way it was creating that triangle is, actually you can just simply refer to the old, I mean this example. So instead of the two lines, if you create one more line between two child agent, you get a shape and then you put surface on it. So that's what's happening in that agent code. And then I wanna show where in the code. So you kind of see that here. So that's here. So similar to the example I just shown on curvature, it's also create a array of I vector, and then you put array of points and then degree and degree. So in case of surface, it's a two-dimensional thing. So you need first, you need two-dimensional control points, not just two or three. It's just a 2x2 or 3x2 or 3 or 4 or 4x4, that number. And you also need to specify the degree for each direction. So surface, number surface has U direction and V direction. So there's a degree for U direction and degree for V direction. You can make one direction polyline like straight and another curvature that's possible. So in this case, it's a 2x2. So wait, the point is 3x3 and degree and 2 and 2. So it's both way curvature. So three, maybe first geometry meaning of geometry, what point is putting 3x3 point is here. It's actually tricky. Maybe I wanna skip the detail, but basically when you have surface and I'm giving 3x3 control points, so I'm just rebuilding the, just I'm showing the example as a, well, like this. So when you have, so this is a surface, is 3x3 points, total 9 points. So I'm trying to create this. So I need to calculate the vector on here and here and here. I need to have 9 of them and then put in a specific order in this array. So, but before that, I made a container, which is the CPTS, control points, with a two-dimensional array. To do that, you just type curly bracket pair twice, and you specify the first one is 3, second one is 3, and then total 3x3 and 9. And then, so this number, putting number is a bit more complicated. So in this case, you have to put two different number, index number, to specify one element inside to the array. So 00 is the first one, first corner, maybe this one, and then 01 would be this one, which is this one. Next would be 02, and then next is actually going up, and the 10, 10. And in the same way, it's 10, 11, 12, and the next 20, 21, 22. So then total you fill 9 points with some specific point, which I'm gonna skip the explanation about that part. But this array of this arrangement of the points creates a specific shape of a triangular tangent shape. Then after you organize those points into 2D array, you just give this array, the whole thing, into I surface, I mean new I surface and the contact points, and then specify this to 2 degree, and you can put some color. So that's what's happening here. So yeah, so that's the way you create surface. I mean one example. I'm gonna also show the another tutorial page, talking more a little bit more detail about the surface creation and the curve creation, which is here. Let me open this one. This is in the tutorial geometry section, and NURBS curve and surface. So this explains the control point. Actually, first some shell crossing, but control point part, and array. First, just curve. So this shows how to make the control points array and they set something, so that seems something else. Actually, this part is talking about how to align tangent or surface and curve. So this is basic. So you create control points and 4 of them, and then you fill them with some number, and you give the control point array into the iCurve with degree and some other example and some other. So this one is a surface example. You put in this case, actually, this is another way of writing array of control points, which doesn't specify 0 or 5 or something. It doesn't say anything, but it starts with a curly bracket and end with curly bracket, and then it contains several points. That's actually, so that was a kind of quicker way to write, quicker than writing down 9 times. But for beginner, it's better to write in this way, although this doesn't show that. But anyway, so those are the example of creating curve and surface. Then going back to the example, maybe I can show you several more examples and then call the day. But this example just shows more stuff going towards that final geometry, core shape geometry. I can just a little bit talk more about a little bit different type of surface. Also, I mean, just contains more number of control points. So this ribbon type of shape, and then this one is created here. Actually, just three of them. It's just one agent contains or creates three different surface. I can just run this code. So this one is there's a Y shape, and then one of the line is one agent, and parent agent, but that one contains three surfaces. There'll be an example, which maybe this is an example. So before creating child agent, this already created three surfaces around it. This might create child agent this way or not, I don't know. So that three surfaces are created here. So there are three lines of I surface method, and then one direction is degree three, which requires 4 points, and another direction is one, the straight part, or the sideway, the straight part. So that's one degree one double surface on one B direction, and the U direction is degree three. And then each of the control point is calculated here. It just uses vector operation to find the point in space. But each of them is containing 4 by 2 points, 8 points. And one side is 4 points. So the first four and the last four is coming from same edge point, four edge point, which calculated somewhere above. But it was adding the depth vector for the first four, but it subtracting the depth vector on the other four. So it's kind of going one direction, then going the other direction to have the width of the strip. Then used for creating its surface. So but anyway, so that's just another case of creating surface using 4x2 point 2D array. Then, and beyond that, in the tutorial, I just complicate more unnecessary for in terms of technical tutorial. Let me skip this one. I mean, if you're interested, just look into more. It is a little bit difficult to write, or just trickier to write. But if you are motivated, you can get through. So, but anyway, so that they are just all kind of more adjustment to have better tangent matching, smoothness, etc., and then closing somewhere. So, but anyway, so but all everything is based on that initial 3-dimensional branching with collision detection. So I kind of reached the end here. But anyway, so those are something you can play with in the assignment as well. So, or you can, okay, so I forgot to mention. So I was going to talk about a little bit of file import from Rhino and also export. So let me touch that part and then finish today's session. And then the example I'm showing right now is basically about multi-agent on surface, but surface is actually imported from Rhino 5. So when you have Rhino 5, I will not explain about how to put agent on surface, but I'm gonna talk about the importing part. Maybe starting. So for example, so this pattern looks like something similar to what we saw before with the branching and then collision detection agent. And it is, but it's just running on the surface imported from Rhino. So let me show how to run this example, because you have to import, you have to save the Rhino file as well. So I want to copy and paste this file. But one problem is that you don't have the Rhino file. This is importing one specific, I mean, Rhino file with a specific file name, but it's not there because I didn't download. So you're gonna crash and complaining about the file found. So first, let me show that part. And the second, I'm gonna import or download the file. By the way, you can down, okay. First, this is the case you see the error. It says error, the file, input file doesn't exist. Name is surface one or something. And then, so first let me find the file in somewhere. Actually, so it's kind of somehow linked here. So you need to download this one as well. Although if you download the zip file, it's contained there. But then let me get this right file first. I'm downloading that somehow reading. So the thing you are supposed to do when you want to import Rhino file is that you put Rhino file in the same folder or somewhere across or underneath of this processing file. To do that, you have to save the processing file first, because otherwise you don't have folder to put Rhino file. So first you save Rhino file. So sketch agent on surface. So I save this surface. So I want to put this Rhino file next to that file. Then I want to go that location. One problem is I already had a Surface 13 file somehow on my download folder, so it automatically changed the file name, but I have to change it back, but because it's written as Surface 13 on the code. So this gonna let the script find that, actually, I can just run that line file. And one thing to note is that when you model something in Rhino, and you when you try to import in processing or in IGO, it's limited to you use only or read only Rhino file version 4, which might be problematic a bit. But I just simply that's because I haven't updated the library that part yet. That's my bug. But anyway, so. So now it's running on the Surface I imported from Rhino. So if you want to just see if it's imported, I can just comment out the agent part. And also I delete the Surface inside the code. I mean, deleted Surface still can be used for agent because the agent can still refer the Surface to know where that is. But just deleting is just hide the Surface. But anyway, if I don't delete, so it should be visible. And then that should be shown there. Not this one. I think it's starting, so it's, yeah. So that's the imported Rhino file. But anyway, yeah, that's something. One thing, another thing to note is that when you model something in Rhino and you think it's time dealing with Surface, and there could be many Surface in one Rhino file, but I'm just specifying the first one because I know I only exported one Surface. But you need to be aware of the difference between Surface and Polysurface. When you think you are making Surface by lofting, extrude that right now, sometime create Polysurface, not Surface. In that case, it cannot be used as Surface. Polysurface is another type and VREP. Actually, Polysurface and VREP is the same thing. So, but if you are dealing with Surface, you need to make sure you are making Surface in Rhino. Then, but anyway, so that's a way to import. Right, fine. Then there's one more way to do that, so let me show that. So one way was to locate Surface next to one same folder with processing sketch file. Another way to do that is there's a menu you can use. There's a sketch menu, and there's a command called add file in sketch menu. When you click that, you can select the Rhino file you want to use. And then, yeah. Then, so if you do that, you're gonna automatically copy the file. So it will not reference the file in your computer. You're gonna just copy the file. And I'm gonna copy the file into the processing sketch folder. So it duplicates, so you kind of need to be aware of that, especially if it's a huge file. So then it doesn't put next to it, it's gonna put inside the folder called data, and it's inside there. So even when you copy and paste by yourself, putting the Rhino file inside the data still works. Putting the file next to the code still works as well. Although in a strict sense of a processing policy, it's supposed to go inside data. So it's better, if you care, it's better way to do, which I don't care. So then, but anyway, that's a two different way. And I don't know what happened if you have two different files in the same folder, which would be bad. So I'm gonna delete one of them. So that was import. Export. Exporting is, so let me run this agent and then show how to save geometry into write file. So, and there are some comments on the Zoom chat. Yeah, IGOpen works only with write for only, yes. And recording, exporting video. Let me save this first. So first is, I'm gonna just stop in the middle, and then saving or exporting is by shortcut. Shortcut is Control S in Windows and Command S in Macintosh. So Control S, if you type Control S, saving window supposed to pop up, but I'm having weird error. The pop-up happening behind the window in the right now, processing three, version three. And then actually somebody was reporting that in Macintosh or Mac OS, that doesn't show up anywhere. Not sure about that one. But anyway, if you don't see the window for saving, search somewhere. It might be popping up somewhere else. So, but anyway, so Control S, Command S, supposed to pop up saving windows, and you can just type file name to save, and output is the name I give. Then hit save button, and it shows how many geometry saved in the processing console, and they should be there. Let me open that. Maybe I should save. In case. No, that. So and let me open the saved geometry from processing, which is output one. So it was just lines but on the surface, but so yeah, you get the geometry from processing, the agent one. So you could say it by writing code if it's like top down, like if you are panelizing everything at once in the beginning, and you can save whole thing by code, but if you are running agent, you kind of need to know when to end and when what to save. So in that case, you have to use shortcut key to save by typing. So anyway, that's that. So okay, then maybe at the end, I'm gonna talk about recording, exporting video. So that's actually, yeah, at the end of this workshop, I'm gonna ask you to design your hierarchical agent stuff, but I wanna ask you to submit not only the code, but the video of that. For that, I might explain that in detail more, but I'm gonna do that quickly, and in case you want to do that today. So that. And there's two bad news. Processing 3, our new processing has some option to automatically generate animation, but you cannot use that for IGO for some reason. And yeah, there's a movie maker, but I don't think this works with IGO. Then, but you can, there's a way to do that, or more traditional way of recording animation. One more bad news is that it doesn't export animation file directly. It only exports each frame as image And then you have to compile like hundreds of images into animation by yourself using some software, Premiere or After Effects or QuickTime Pro. Or I'm sure there's some other shareware type of stuff or maybe free software, which I don't know. Maybe I'm gonna look into that later. So, so I'm gonna show you how to save each frame of simulation. So to do that, first you need to do in draw method. You need a draw method in the code. So you have setup, you have class, but between, I mean, doesn't matter where, actually it cannot be inside the class, but outside of class and possibly below setup, you make a method called draw. I'm gonna send you this code later over email as well. So then there's one method in processing which captures the screen and the save as file, which is called save frame. And in the save frame, you are supposed to give input of file name. So or you can also specify folder. Usually I make folder, or I don't need to make, but just give name of folder. If you type slash, it's recognized as a folder, and if that folder doesn't exist already, processing gonna create automatically. And then one thing is that this is going to create hundreds or thousands of images. So you need to give file name, but you need to give file name for that hundreds of file. And the way you do that is by pound sign, but actually I'm gonna make like, you can give name, but you can, there's a place, the processing gonna give like a number, like a frame 0001 or 002 and 3 and 4 for the other software to compile. And you can give, you can make a space location to put that number. And then, but the total number or length of the pound kind of matters. If you have only 3 or 2, it can only save like a 0 to 99 and only 100. And usually you create either 1,000 frame or several thousand, so you put 3 or 4 pound sign. Then at the end you give, or some people like to put hyphen. Then at the end you can specify the file format. I think you can either use the JPEG or PNG. I tend to use JPEG. And then that's basically that's it. And then some people like to finish automatically, like if you just keep running and then leave, it just create a forever, or save the file forever. And then some people like to limit, like you want to end in 1,000 or something, but okay, that kind of thing I'm gonna talk about later. But for example, this one, let me show what's gonna happen with this. And it's starting. When this starts, it's gonna automatically create the folder and start saving. And okay, it's starting. And that just created the folder. And it's saving right now. So it's now saving files for each frame, then it's increasing. So that's how you capture that. And then camera and the focus, another thing, so I'm gonna talk about later again, or tomorrow or day after. So at least I can show you one thing, like if you don't want 3 or 4 view, if you just want to see perspective and then maybe focus, you can specify that by there's 4 view selection, which is, okay, it can happen here. IG.parse and then empty parentheses, that gives you, that chooses as a perspective view. In the same way, there's IG.top and IG. I forgot what is side, front. I think there's a front and back and then also bottom. I don't show back on the right. Would be the another view. Yeah, that was right view. I think this is right. But anyway, so there's 4 different view you can choose. there's also left. But if you want to, if you don't want to show full view in the animation, you can do this too. So I think that's all. Then, do you have any other question before finishing today? Let me check the YouTube as well. Let's think. So, okay, if not, yeah, I think this is side view. So, right and left will be side view. So, oh, my YouTube frozen. But anyway, so that's it. And so again, the assignment of today is that design your own multi-agent code with interaction or most likely collision detection or something we went through as an example today, and just develop further as your version and just try to make something you like. And then yeah, you're gonna present again like in the same way we did today. So that's the assignment. Okay. So again, thank you everybody for participation today, and I'm gonna see you tomorrow in the same time again. All right, bye.